tilting. There we go. Good evening, everybody. And check on my settings. Good evening, everybody. It's Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. This is my Monday night webinar. It's Monday, the 22nd of June, 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Hey, Meerkat, what's going on? I love everybody on Meerkat. Thanks a lot for liking and retweeting the show. And feel free to do that at any time. Also, if you want to post me a question, post it right in there, and I'll be more than happy to answer your question. If anybody misses any part of this show, all of my Monday and Wednesday shows are always on YouTube. And then my Saturday radio show, which is live on the air, is also posted on YouTube. And for all my folks that are on watching on Webinar Jam, what you can do is make sure that you post your questions to admin only. So you can either post a question or chat with me to admin only, and I'll answer all of your questions. Remember, everybody, this is my itinerary. I have none. The show is for you. Ask any of your dog training questions. I will give you an immediate dog training answer. I'm not one of the people that have to think about it. I will give you an answer right away. If you're new to me, I know a lot of people are on Meerkat are brand new to me. So, hey, Bob, how you doing? And I want to just let you know, I'm a real dog trainer. I've got a dog training facility. It's about 17,000 square feet in Providence, Rhode Island. We specialize in aggression rehabilitation, and we put about 200 dogs a year through our board and train program. And I also travel the country as well as Canada. And then I also go over to Europe training dogs. I do seminars as well as one-on-one. Bob says, hi, Jeff. We have a six-month-old English setter puppy. He was 4 months when we got him, and he had no training whatsoever at this point. No big deal. Most don't. We'd like to get him crate trained, but we're afraid he may have separation anxiety. We were told it was a bad idea to crate train a dog with separation anxiety. Okay, so Bob, so whoever told you that advice, I want you to give them the dog and let them deal with the poo and the pee all over their house. So yeah, you'll have a dog with no separation anxiety, but the dog pees and poos all over the house. That's a win-win for everybody now, isn't it? Separation anxiety is easy to fix. Pooing and peeing, hard to fix. So crate train, and first of all, this is just, what's it called when you don't really know if it's gonna happen, but it might happen? What's that called? What? Foreshadowing, guessing, stupid, predicting, right? I've got two guests in the, right? So I've got, unfortunately, folks on my webinar won't be able to see this, but hello, in from Texas. They're in here. They're actually shadowing me for the week. They're wonderful people. Well, introduce yourselves.
I'm Brandy.
From?
Lovable. I'm Ariel from Lovable, Austin, Texas.
Awesome rescue. Pitbull Rescue based in Texas, and fantastic folks, and they just got here late last night, and but they did drive they did drive 1,000 miles a day, so kudos to them. So first of all, Bob, we don't know if your dog's gonna have separation anxiety or not. So this is the thing. I want you to crate train your dog. I want your dog in the crate all night long. When you're out of the house, I want your dog to be crated. The fact that your dog may have separation anxiety, I can also get rid of that. So let's do this. Let's guarantee that your dog will not soil the house. Let's guarantee that your dog will not destroy the house by crating your dog. Separation anxiety, I've got a video on separation anxiety. So in the meantime, before separation anxiety happens, watch my video on YouTube, 13 ways to prevent and eliminate separation anxiety. Follow it to the T. You will not have it. Let me give you a good idea. Half the dogs that come into my, we got a bad internet connection. Something happened to my Meerkat connection. Sorry, Meerkat, you can only hear me only. That should be, you had improved in a while. I'm not quite sure what's going on with that. Watch the video. And what you're going to do is you're going to see that you will not have any problem whatsoever. Follow it to the T. Let me try one thing. Hold on. Oh, there we go. And it's back. There we go. There we go. Okay. Sorry about that, Meerkat. That was a, it's really weird. We're getting a really weak internet signal. Huh. Anyway, so Bob, what I want you to do is I want you to do all of that. Half the dogs that come into our property are on their application. It says they have separation anxiety. Half of them. That's a lot of dogs. I want you to know that no dog exhibits separation anxiety symptoms within 24 hours of arrival on our property. That means we eliminate it or prevent it in one day. So we have dogs that have separation anxiety for years. For years, it's gone in a day. Why? Because owners create separation anxiety. That is why. It is an owner manifestation, owner manifested issue, and we can eliminate it very, very, very easily. So, all right, let's get the questions in, guys. We need a lot of questions. Just keep in mind, everybody during the week, I get dozens of emails, tweets, Facebook messages, and phone messages. Everybody calls me up, writes to me with anything from one sentence to one page full of information. They want help with their dog training. Unfortunately, all they get back from me is a cut and paste reply that pretty much says, I'm too busy to even read your question, let alone answer your question. I don't say that out of disrespect. I say it because I actually am. So I offer these Monday and Wednesday webinars and Saturday radio show all for free. So now is the time to ask your questions. What I also do is I also have over 1,000 videos on YouTube, and you can actually fully off-leash train your dog by watching the videos. You actually don't have to hire me. You don't have to hire me at all. You don't have to actually hire any dog trainer. You can watch these videos. So what I would suggest you do before you spend any money on any dog trainer, including myself, is watch my videos, watch a couple of months worth of podcasts, and next thing you know, you've got the dog that you want.
Looking at your sticker.
Oh. How do you muzzle Taya? How do you muzzle a board and trained dog that has aggression towards you? That's really, really hard to do. So imagine this. So a dog comes in with, I'm assuming it's human aggression. So what I would do is, Taya, the protocol we have with this is we want all dogs that have got human aggression to be muzzle conditioned prior to them coming into us. So we tell the owners we'd like the dogs to be muzzle conditioned prior to coming into us. If you can't do that, you've got your work cut out for you. What I'd like you to do then is then ask your clients to put a dominant dog collar on the dog. So if you don't know what a dominant dog collar is, you can look it up, just Google it. A dominant dog collar on the dog, and you put a long line on the dog. So put about a 15-foot long line on the dog. And you have that long line attached to the collar, having it come out of the kennel. Now, is there a risk to that? Absolutely. What's the risk? Dog could die. Fully understand that. But what's the other risk? You can't get the dog out of the kennel because it's trying to attack you. So remember, some people won't be able to grasp this, and some people might not quite understand because they don't have a dog that tries to bite them, let alone a 150-pound dog that wants to try to kill them. Those are the dogs that we deal with, though. So this way now you always have leash control. What happens if the dog bites through the leash? It could happen. What do? You put another leash on the dog. Hopefully your training facility has more than one leash. If it doesn't, increase your prices, buy more leashes. If that can't be done, how do you do it? Force. That's it. You got to use force. Rabies pull, put the dog's head to the ground, have an assistant come in, put a muzzle on the dog. A lot of pressure, a lot of stress. But what you should also start doing is start muzzle conditioning the dog. So what I want you to do, Taya, is get a Baskerville muzzle, okay? Get a bunch of kibble in your hand. You put the Baskerville muzzle right on top of your hand. You hold the muzzle up to the dog. The only way that dog eats is out of a muzzle. That's it. The only way that dog eats. You've got to get the muzzle on the dog. Also, I suggest you also get a slip lead. While the dog is eating, you can also put a slip lead on the dog. there's a lot of different ways to do it. So we've had to do it many, many different ways. So a slip lead is easy. A muzzle you can do. You can put it on yourself, muzzle condition the dog. But from the minute that dog comes in, the only time it eats is out of a muzzle. Never let it eat out of a bowl. Keeping a leash on the dog at all times, though, is key with all your human aggressive dogs. We deal with a lot of human aggressive dogs, and there's not a lot of trainers that do. If you're just getting into training, I recommend don't do it. So I've got a really big ego right now. Well, not just right now, all my life. But my ego back when I first started in the dog training was humongous to the point where I was getting bit way too much. Why? All new dog trainers are really cocky, and we want to work with the most aggressive dogs out there. So now I work with even more aggressive dogs than I used to, but I'm not getting bit at all. Why? I got really good, really smart, lots of experience, and I put my ego into check. That's why. All right. Hopefully that answered your question. Okie doke. Elisa, I'm fostering a 4-year-old English Springer Spaniel, following your lessons for leash training, trying to train for kennel up, but he will not go in the crate at all. He's like a mule and won't budge. What should I do? Also, he starts spinning quite a bit. What can I do to calm him down? Okay. Elisa, you can get that dog in that crate. Absolutely. So do it a couple of ways. Number one, food, right? Food. How is the dog eating? Is the dog eating out of the crate? Why? Why is the dog eating out of the crate when you're trying to get the dog into the crate? Feed the dog in the crate. Put kibble in there. But we get dogs into crates in about 30 seconds or less, even the ones that don't want to go in. So what we do is this. Leash on the dog. Training collar on the dog. Take your leash. I've got kennel up videos. I've got a lot of kennel up videos, and I also demonstrated it at all of my seminars, at all my RV dog training seminars. There's always one dog that doesn't want to go in the crate. Never gone in the crate. Fights like hell. The owner does it right in front of us. They can't get it done. I walk up. It's not magic, but I get it done. This is why. I know the dog could do it. So number one, you have to know the dog can do it. So hold the leash really close to the dog's head, walk up, be moving, kennel up, force your arm right into there. Don't let go. Keep it in there. If you've got to take your foot, don't kick the dog. If you've got to move your foot and sort of like push the dog's butt in there with it, do it. Close the door. Open the door. If the dog tries to come out, close the door. I've got a great video on waiting at thresholds of the crate. I just put up a new video last week with a dog that just came in. Now, open the door, the dog waits, call the dog out. Again, kennel up, force. Dog will probably do it a little bit less. Same protocols, wait, come out. So every time do it. What you can also do is you also can take a long line, stick it through the end of the crate. So if this is the door, this is the back, you take the long line, you stick it through the back, you have somebody on the other end. So you walk up with your slip lead or your leash, the other person has the long line, they're pulling the dog in, you're pretending you're walking up, kennel up, they pull that dog in, you drag that dog in. Sounds mean? It is not mean. I'll tell you what's mean. Your dog not listening to you is mean. All right? If you can't get that dog in the crate, you know what's going to happen? That dog will be flipping you the finger for the rest of the training sessions. All right? So I want you to do that. Second part of your question is, he starts spinning quite a bit. How do you stop spinning? Don't let the dog do it. Stop the spinning. How do you do it? Downstay or place. Downstay. When a dog is lying down, what is it not doing? It's not spinning. So what does that dog do? Like right now, to all the folks on Meerkat, you get the fortunate things of seeing this. So Angelo, Ange, say hi. Girl, Uma, Ange. Okay, guess what? The kid ain't spinning, the dogs ain't spinning. Why? Because they're down. They're in place, they're in a stationary place. That's why. That's how you fix that. All right. Okay, BJ. Okie doke. let's see, two-part question, I think. We have a two-plus-year-old boxer who acts like he has ADHD and our one-and-a-half-year-old and now fight. So you have two dogs that are fighting. It's terrible. I would hope so. We have had to keep them apart now, which is a chore in our house. It's been a couple of months. They want to instantly fight if you try to walk them together, yet they are fine with each in crates. The year-old is a German Shepherd dog who used to cower down to the boxer, but no longer does that. So two fighting dogs in the same house. We get a lot of that as well. This is what I want you to do. First of all, the dogs need to know they're not allowed to fight. Okay. For all the folks that are watching me at Webinar Jam, go into your chat box, ask me questions. Hey, everybody over on Meerkat, you could actually type me in a question right there. Also, retweeting this and liking this, I really appreciate it. Thank you so much, guys, on Meerkat. I really appreciate, you know, your support. It means a lot to me. So what I want you to do is this. You've got to start doing massive amounts of structure. I want both those dogs on training cowers. When I say training cower, it is a prong cower. We train dogs on prong cowers and remote cowers. If anybody has a problem with that type of training, that's fine, but you probably don't want to watch my show. But you could watch my show, forget about the tools that I use, and listen to my philosophy, and then use the tools you want to use. Your dog will be better off. Why do I use the tools that I want to use? Because my clients aren't dog trainers. And I also like to make things easier for the dog, easier for the client. And I also don't want to spend 6 months to a year training things that can be done in a week and sometimes even a day. So I want those dogs walking next to each other. I want those dogs in place next to each other. I want them in down next to each other. I want those dogs then crated next to each other. You need to start creating calmer energy. Chances are the energy in your house is not balanced. I want you to make sure you've got balanced energy. Wow. For some reason, I'm only doing... hold on, guys. Give me a 30-second break here. Meerkat, hold on. I don't know what the heck's going on. That's so weird how I couldn't get, oh, there we go. Okay, I just had to change my internet connection. I was on the wrong thing. We have the proper, my home, I've got an extender, one of those router extenders, and you were actually hooked up to the router extender, so you kept fading in and out. All right, so what I want you to do is, I want you to make sure that those dogs have no free roaming, absolutely no free roaming in the house. They do not roam. They have no freedom. I want you to take away 90% of all love and affection. Love and affection doesn't help, right? You got fighting dogs. You're giving them love and affection. Obviously, that doesn't work. Take it away. All right, that's a start right there. I want you to go to my YouTube channel underneath How to Dog Training. I want you to follow every single rule. I want those dogs off of furniture, out of the bed. I want things to be non-negotiable. Non-negotiable. Got it? Meaning, yeah, I said down. Yeah, I said place. Yep, walk next to me. Nope, you can't pee over there. Nope, you can't bark in your crate. Start with that. All right? Kira. Hi, Jeff. My 18-month-old lab mastiff rescue is overstimulated, mouthing, jumping on guests, and has no recall. Okay? She seemed to respond well to clicker training. Okay? When I got her 6 months ago, but no matter how much I try, when the treats are gone, she stops responding. That sounds very familiar to me. We got a prong collar today, and she's responding well in just a few hours following your videos. I also hear that a lot. Number one, how can I get her to be calm when we have guests over? Good question. She gets tons of exercise. Has nothing to do with it. How do I keep her from lunging, barking on our walks? She's still reactive with strangers and dogs. Okay. I absolutely do not discount clicker training at all. But remember, clicker training trains, okay, positive reinforcement, and you will never hear me talk science on the show, and I will kick you off my show for talking science. I'm not talking science here, but positive reinforcement reinforces a wanted command. It does not eliminate an unwanted behavior. Never has, never will. It's impossible. It hasn't been proven. Show me the video. Okay. And if you think you can rehabilitate an aggressive dog by not using an aversive, a correction, a punishment, I'll give you $25,000 and I'm serious. Okay. I've got a challenge out there. If you've never heard the show before, I put 25 grand in escrow. You put 25 grand in escrow. You get an aggressive dog that we both agree is aggressive. You rehabilitate that dog so it is not aggressive without ever using an aversive. You get the $25,000 in yours. The thing is, after the first training session, I will win. It's impossible. Can't be done. It's never been done, never been proven. Anyway, so what I want you to do is this. Don't let her greet people. Why does your dog have to greet people? My dogs don't greet people, right? My dogs mind their own business. My dogs listen to me. I don't want a lab mastiff mix greeting me. I want to come in your house and I don't want to, I want your dog out of my way. I don't want your dog jumping on me. I don't want your dog sniffing my crotch. I don't want your dog getting underfoot. I don't want your dog bringing me toys. I didn't come over for your dog. I came over to see you. So teach your dog the place command. Okay. The place command you should be practicing at all times. Dogs go to a mat. Dogs go to a bed. They stay on the mat. They stay on the bed. Guests come over. They stay there. Food's on the table. Food's on the counter. Kids are running around. Kids are playing with their toys. Kids have friends over. Dog doesn't move. Why? So you can exist with your dog. The greatest reward in the world is existence. So I've got two dogs, two humans. Well, Angelo's a human, but he's a little kid. Could you imagine if these two dogs, very large German Shepherds in a small 150 square foot room, were moving around? No, you can't. What's the reward for being well behaved? You get to do my webinars with me. That's it. So, lunging and barking on the walks, you've got to get better control of the walk. So what you've got to do is you've got to get better control of the walk. I want you to watch my video. Chances are what you're doing is you're giving your dog information too late on the walk. Remember, the prong collar doesn't do the training, just like the clicker didn't do the training, okay? The prong collar helps you communicate the training. So what you've got to do is you've got to be having that dog on your left-hand side or your right-hand side. I prefer the left. Left-hand side. I want it at my leg or behind my leg. If it moves in front of me, I give it information, which is a little leash pop. I've got so many videos on this. Watch my videos. Start out with that. Okay, let me just erase some questions here. Let me go to Meerkat. Hey, guys, thank you so much. Queenie is, Queenie is resisting to my putting the prong collar on. She's kennel trained, and I've tried to put the collar on before. Okay, so Linnie, your dog, it's a pain in the ass. Correct? Am I right? Agree with me here? How about this? You don't eat till you let me put that collar on. Simple. You will not have one morsel of food until you allow me to put the prong collar. Now, some of the people out there that don't like prong collars, like, that's because the dog doesn't like the prong collar. F you, you're wrong. You have no idea what you're talking about. Okay? I rehabilitated a dog. The dog's name is Rupert. Look for the video. You have any collar at all, nylon collar, martingale collar, the dog would attack you, put you in the hospital. Guess what? You want to eat today? I put the collar on. Oh, you attack me? You wiggle? You worm? No food. Tomorrow, let's try this again. Oh, you wiggle? You worm? No food. Day three, let's put the collar on. Oh, you're going to let me put the collar on? Good. You get one morsel of food now. Good. Take the collar off. Collar, give it a name. Collar, you get one more morsel of food. And you'll do this hundreds of times. Guess what? When you say the word collar, that dog will run over to you and stick its head out and beg you to put the collar on. That's how we're going to do that. All right? Okay. Hi, Jeff. It's Maureen, the aggressive German Shepherd puppy owner. She's still aggressive towards food. We removed the garbage can, but it's not rehabilitating her. Of course it's not. Maureen, listen to me. you can't fix this on your own. You, first of all, you're going to have to fix it with a remote collar. Okay. You have to correct the dog. Removing the food isn't going to work. So I taught you obedience work. The only way you are going to be able to fix and eliminate permanently your dog who is acting food aggressive. Remember, I do this for a living. I do it daily. I do it around the world. That dog needs to get a very high correction for aggressing towards you for food. I use remote collars 90% of the time at low levels, below what humans can feel. But when it comes to food aggression, I use it at one level, the highest level. We're not talking about obedience now. Nobody take this soundbite out and try to replay it. Maybe you look like the evil devil. It's already been done. Nobody's impressed. Not even myself. I laugh. If you're going to make hate, if you're going to make a hate video over me, it's Jeff Gellman, Solid Canine Training. Get my website, my Facebook, my Instagram page. Put it all out there. Tell people to send me hate mail. Make sure, Jeff at Solid Canine Training. Okay, I'm on the radio. Cumulus radio station, one of the largest radio stations in the country. Send them hate mail. Tell them you hate me, you want me off the air. My general manager's name is Joe Lembo. Attention, Joe. Jeff is mean to dogs and abuses dogs. Send him hate mail. Okay? Seriously, do it right. If you're going to do hate mail, do it right. You've got to correct the dog on the highest level. You have got to put that dog into so much discomfort that it never wants to aggress. Everyone's going to disagree. Not everyone's going to disagree. Oh, no, you don't have to do that. You know, when it doesn't aggress towards you, be nice. Bullshit. How about when it tries to bite your face off? Then what do you do? Seriously. This is not to you, Maureen, but I ask this to dog trainers all the time. So I've got a food aggressive dog, and when it's nice, I give it food. Okay, what happened? What do you do when it bites your face off? You know what you do? You fire the client. You recommend the dog to be killed. What do? I rehabilitate the dog. So you need a remote collar. Your timing has to be right. I do not recommend you do this at home. You've got to get the dog to me, or you've got to get the dog to someone else that specializes in training like I do. So what I'm going to tell you to do now is that dog should not have access to the food. You did not have to remove that trash can. The dog shouldn't have access to where the trash can is. The dog should have a leash on, prong collar on at all times. The dog should be in a crate or in down. The dog should have no free roaming at all. Take away any love and affection you give this dog whatsoever. No hugs, no kisses, no good boy. That's it. That dog is to work and to work only. That dog should not have access to the trash can. I want that dog always in command. I want that dog to go on structured walks, structured potty breaks, structured training, structured exercise, back in the crate. That's it. Nothing. Because your dog is halfway dead. You know it and I know it. Because if you can't get that dog from attacking you over food, you're going to turn it into a shelter. The shelter will kill it that day. There's no rescues that will take aggressive dogs. They say they do, but they don't. They're lying to you. They want your money. And then what they do is they kill the dog. They make up some fantasy story that they rehabilitated it and it adopted some couple in Iowa. Bullshit. There's no way are there a ton of people in Iowa with aggressive German Shepherds. They're not. Buffalo, they are. Detroit, maybe. Okay, so you didn't get rid of her. You're not going to get rid of it. You can't get rid of it in just a couple of days. Food aggression, it's aggressive. It's aggressive. You need to do a Skype visit. You're going to have to invest in a Skype visit with me. It won't be fixed through just back and forth texting. It won't. But I want you to know, if I had that dog in front of me, I would fix it in 30 seconds or less. That's why I know I can do it. But in this format, it's really, really hard to do. Okay. Kira, thank you. The place command makes so much sense. Really excited to follow your podcast and videos. So much improvement in one day. Ooh, I think I'm going to broadcast your question. So now I broadcast your question. Everybody on the webinar sees your question. Pretty cool. Isn't that cool? Okay. Jessica, how do I stop my dog barking when he's in a downer in place? He doesn't break place, but if someone knocks, he barks and seems confused if I leash pop. I don't think he knows that I want him to stop barking. I want him to stop when I say quiet. Okay, teach him quiet, remote collar. Put a bark collar on him. Do a remote collar. So remote collar, quiet, stim. Quiet, stim. Quiet, stim. Ooh, barking is uncomfortable. I think I'll stop barking. That's exactly how you do it. What's the consequence for unwanted barking? What's the consequence? It has to be a motivation enough to stop it. Please don't train the quiet command and reward with food. Stupid idea. Bark, 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 bark. Quiet. Treat. That dog's like, I can use a little appetizer right about now. I think I'll start barking. Yep, look at that. Look at my stupid owner. Runs over to me and gives me food to tell me to shut up. So that you don't want to do. So consequence. That's really funny. Maureen says, thank you. By the way, we're in Buffalo. That's why she's still alive. That was really good. Maureen, give Tyler a call. Give Tyler a call, okay? Give Tyler a call. I will be, Buffalo, you are one day drive away from me. Go to my, okay, keep your dog alive and keep everybody from getting bit and come to my seminar at the end of August. Seriously, okay? Your life will change in a day. Okay, Meerkat, I see you guys. Don't worry. I'm going to get you. What electric collar do you suggest for a boxer and a German Shepherd breed? Breed doesn't matter. Get the go to ecollar.com, ecollar.com, and get the Mini Educator 300. You can also buy them right off of my website, solidcaninetraining.com. We carry them. I really don't care if you're buying from me or not. Buying from Amazon. I'm not in the buying and selling business. I'm in the training business. Nancy says, I don't see the difference between a choke collar and a dominant dog collar. It is. Dominant dog collars are very, very thin. And choke collars are not. They're not as thin. A dominant dog collar is very, very thin. Also on a dominant dog collar, the way they're sized, they don't slip over the dog's head. Only about that much is left. So in order to engage that dominant dog collar, you only have to push up a little bit. Okay, Maureen, the only way I can help you is a Skype visit or in person. Okay, a food aggressive dog, I can't help you. In this format, unless you get a remote collar and a Skype visit. Get a remote collar and a Skype visit, and we will do a live training session. All right? It's not going to happen through this. It won't happen through this. Okay. All right, guys. Well, let me go over to Meerkat. Hey, Meerkat. Love you guys. Let's see. We have two pit bulls. The male is mixed and the female is not mixed or fixed. My female is too attached to me. I'm more concerned when it stopped right there. So, MZ Katu, your question stopped. I only got part of it. Is that because I can't read the whole question? I'm not seeing your whole question here, but okay. If one of your dogs is too attached to you, what I want you to do is I want you to start getting your dog to be away from you. So I want that dog crated. I want that dog in the place command. I want that dog not be allowed to hang out with you. Start creating space. Don't allow that dog to follow you around. It's annoying, right? Show of hands. We're on the toilet. Our dog's in front of us. Me, I don't like it. You, maybe. That's another problem. We can talk about that. In fact, I'll give you a referral on that one. What I want you to do is get the dog to be away from you. Space. Space. It makes us feel good that the dogs are next to us, but it creates separation anxiety. Okay. R2 Robinson, Jeff, great show. Can you walk through how you use the prong collar and the remote collar in tandem when training? Aye, aye, aye. This is a 1 hour show. Okay. What I do with this is when the dog is on the remote collar, we're actually getting off of the prong collar. So the remote collar we do, and she's in Texas. Go Texas, by the way. Go Texas, yeah. I was in Texas. Listen, I was just in Austin and Dallas. I love Texas. I'd move to Texas. In fact, I might move to Texas because there's no dogs that work with hardcore aggression in Texas. So I might go there. So what I want you to do is the way we do the remote collar, prong collar is it's going to be, and don't worry, I'm gonna get to everybody's questions tonight. Okay. I'm gonna get to everybody's question tonight. It's gonna go longer than I thought, but don't worry, I'll get to everybody's questions. Okay. You know me, I like to talk. Okay. So on the walk, what we do on the walk is we use the prong collar and the remote collar at the beginning, like clutching gas. And then the prong collar we can use for directional control if the dog lunges, but we want to use the remote collar. So we actually get the dog off the prong collar. You actually can use just a basic flat buckle collar with the remote. But for all the interior work, we train the dog while it's transitioning to the remote. We still use the prong. So we still use the prong. Okay. Kira says, how many people are in your RV sessions? I see you're in Toronto in October. I am in Toronto in October. We limit it to 15 dogs and pretty much unlimited people because as many people as possible can audit it because they're sort of just in the background. But working spots, there's 15. It's a two-day seminar. I work with every dog. It's the triage model. So Kira, what you would do is I would look at you and I would say, Kira, you look really nice today. I really like that outfit. Nice hair. Did you just get it done? Kira, I would look at you and what I would do is I would say, what's your dog's issue? Great. Bring your dog up. Boom. Let's fix it. That's how I work. That is really how I work. I don't need to think about how to fix it. I don't care what your, my dog kills children. Okay, cool. This is what you're going to do. My dog attacks men with sunglasses and hoodies on. I grab my sunglasses and my hoodie and we start working. So whatever your issue is, I work on it. Is your dog going to leave fully trained? Absolutely not. Is your dog going to be more than 100% better? Absolutely yes. We're talking years and years of bad behaviors from some of these dogs fixed in a weekend. Why? It's what I do for a living. It's what I do for a living. And I wouldn't be able to say that and do 22 seminars a year. All right? There's no way I'd be able to say that and do 22 seminars a year. I make them low cost because they're geared towards dog owners because you guys are struggling. I can't stand to see humans struggle. So my RV seminars are $200 or $300. Canada, the price is more. Like it's like $379 Canadian, I think, compared to my other seminars, which are $3,500. So my RV seminars are really, really low cost. 15 dogs, the great thing about having only 15 dogs, you get to not only watch me work with your dog, you will actually work with your dog, but you get to see what I do with all the other dogs. So you learn, you take back all these little morsels of information with your own dog. If your dog's a dog aggressive, great, bring it. There's a lot of dogs there. Human aggressive, great, bring it. There's humans there. Whatever your dog's issue is, I can handle it. There's no restriction on behavior. If you're like, my dog wants to kill every dog, great, bring your dog. There'll be a lot of dogs there for your dog to try to kill. But guess what? It ain't going to be killing any dogs. Never will happen. We'll resolve it. Now, if your dog has human aggression and dog aggression, we want you to start muzzle training it now. Because we're going to want to muzzle on your dog to start working on it. But then, believe it or not, by the second day, most dogs are off muzzle, lying on the floor, all quiet. I mean, just look at all the photos that I put up. I put up photos and slideshows all the time. All right, Kara? It'd be great to see you there. Ah, coffee break. He likes to do it himself. Yep. Okay. Technical difficulties over there on the couch. Okay. Is food aggression when a dog will take food from you on the table where you're sitting? That's nasty. No, that's not food aggression at all. That's actually really, really rude, disrespectful behavior, which should never happen. I can't imagine even living in that world, Nancy. So you're sitting at the table. So you're sitting at the table having food and a dog comes up and takes food from you. I can't even imagine that happening. That's a mama question. You got to go find mama. We'll help you out. We got a technical difficulty. Okay. Technical difficulty. Food aggression is your dog attacks you when you try to get by its food bowl or take food bowl from its mouth. But for you, Nancy, if your dog is doing that behavior to you, that's a bigger issue. Michelle. Hi, Jeff. My question is, how do you maintain quiet with all the dogs in your facility? I put a bark collar on Chance. It works. He barks, it zaps, and then he cries, but continues to bark. You don't want him to set the girls off when they get back. Okay. Your dogs don't bark in the kennel. So you're better off putting remote collars on your dog. You're better off putting a remote collar. They make a tiny little bark collar. So if the dog is barking and then crying, it might be too high, believe it or not. So it might be too high. Okay. Taya says, when breaking up a dog fight, does it really work to stick your finger in their butt? Yes, it does. What's so funny?
I've never heard it work.
Yeah, it doesn't work all the time, but what you do is that you stick your finger in their butt. So you're getting into a fist fight?
Yeah.
Okay, you're fighting.
Yeah.
Pulling someone's hair, right? Choking them. Somebody walks up to you, sticks their finger in their butt, your butt. What are you doing?
I would stop.
There you go.
there you go.
Your
finger up my butt.
That's right.
In a fist fight,
right,
I
right.
Stop.
I turn around, give him a 20 and keep fighting. You know? So that's the difference between you and me, right? All right. All right, Nancy, no, my dogs are not allowed by the table. I just wanted to know what it was. I know, Nancy. So hopefully, Nancy, you'll know that there's a little bit of sarcasm in this, right? A little bit of sarcasm. I got a sick sense of humor. But the bottom line is I get really good results. So so don't take it personally. Don't take it personally. But no, resource guarding is, remember, Nancy, resource guarding is anything. So a lot of people associate it with bones, food, and toys, but a dog can actually resource guard a leaf, air, space, a human. So resource guarding is anything the dog deems worth guarding. And sometimes it's like whack-a-mole. Sometimes it's like you get them to stop guarding the food, and now they guard the water bowl. You get them to stop guarding the water bowl, and now they guard their dog bed. It's anything. In my world, everything belongs to me. You've got limited time on this planet, so don't growl or bite me. And guess what? My dogs do not live in fear. My dogs listen to my two-year-old. If anybody is new to me, what you can do is you can go back into my YouTube channel. Last summer, when Angelo was like less than a year and a half old, he can walk into a yard with 20 dogs in it. 20 dogs. Like, 1.5 to 2-year-old child, not one dog would bother him. Ever. He can make grunting noises and dogs would listen to him. You think those dogs are afraid of him? Absolutely not. You know what the magic was with Angelo? This is what it was. There's a really cute video of Angelo. Taking 6 dogs from a play yard into the kennel with grunting noises. They followed him. Big German Shepherds, pit bull, everything. One of the best dogs that he worked with is a Turkish Kengel. Turkish Kengel, dog's 150 pounds, bred to kill wolves. It's humongous. It stands up. It's taller than me. Angelo can tell him what to do. And guess what? The dog can be aggressive when he needs to be. But just because I talk about correcting dogs, that does not mean dogs are afraid of me. Why? Because there's a balance and because I'm fair. So I'm fair. If I get caught for speeding going 95 miles an hour in a $55 ticket in a 55 mile per hour zone, am I mad at the police officer? I better not be. I better take 100% responsibility for my actions. I should be mad at myself, right? Anyway, Rhonda says, I like your nonsense attitude. It helps me stay strong. Oh, I'll broadcast that. Hi, Jeff. Thank you for your help and support. Actually, I'm actually moving to Dallas in a few weeks. Hopefully you can refer me to a great trainer to work with. Cool, Brian. Yes, I'll be able to by then. But Brian, go to my Dallas seminar. Go to my Austin or Dallas. Austin is in November. Dallas has not been announced yet. That's in December. All right. Brooke, Thanks for the do-it-yourself dog swimming videos. Today, I finally taught my dog to swim. Yes. After weeks of him being fearful of the water, it was a little different in a lake instead of a pool, but it worked just as well. Ta-da! Shouldn't there be like music now? Like, ta-da! Like, who's that? Who's that? Like, shouldn't there be like a big group? What do they call that? A group of people that sing together?
Chorus.
Shouldn't there be like a big chorus, like hallelujah chorus, you know? Hallelujah, hallelujah. Awesome. Thank you. We train dogs. And you know what? Let me explain my semi-cockiness to major cockiness to sarcasm. This is the thing. In my industry, anytime a dog is acting aggressive, it's told to be killed. We're killing 4 to 5 million dogs a year. Your average dog trainer will never work with an aggressive dog, badly behaved dog. Could you imagine this? Imagine this scenario. You ready? You've got a leash reactive dog. Leash reactive dog is, it's on the end of the leash, pulling and yanking and barking at other dogs. You go to a business, a place of business. The place of business, there's a sign over the place of business that says dog training. You go to their website and the website says dog reactivity, aggression, leash pulling. Okay. So you're advertising that you promote, you work on these things. And I go to your class and my dog is out of control. And you know what you say to me? Excuse me, you have to leave until your dog gets more in control. I want you to know this happens to everybody, a lot of my clients. So, doc, my foot here, it's broken. And you got a sign that says the doctor of broken feet. And you send me away because it's too broken? You got to be freaking killing me. No, do your job. So I struggle with the ethics of dog training. Okay. I struggle with people just because a dog is leash reactive or supposedly aggressive, it gets put down. You know, the video that I put up of that, Tiga, the video of Tiga that I put up of the first 24 hours, 90% of dog trainers, 90% of dog trainers would say that's an aggressive dog and it could be put down. I guarantee it. I know it would. Why? Because I've had dogs easier than that dog that have been told to be put down. Within 24 hours, that dog was next to my dogs walking down the street just fine. Why? Because we're balanced. That's why. Anyway, Brian says, absolutely, we'll be attending your seminar. We had a really great results from the last one. Awesome. And Brian, think about how much progress you're going to make by then. Okay, hold on. Doug. Hey, Doug. Is a male dog mounting another male dog that is brought into the house bullying or something else? Well, in 42 states, they're not allowed to get married. That's for sure. It's dominant. Put it this way. I'm not going to call it bullying. I'm not going to call it dominance. I'm going to call it unacceptable, and it gets corrected. Let's keep it at that. So, Doug, you know I don't like – Doug's a regular fan of mine. He's actually a super fan. Doug, you know I don't like to look too deep into things. A dog mounting another dog, let's call it unacceptable and correct it. So we had some mounting today going on, right? Mm-hmm. Right. Okay. They wanted lunch and they didn't have any money. So we had to barter. So they had your husband's not listening.
He might be.
Come on. Isn't he like in Afghanistan? Oh, he's in a place we can't mention, but he's one of those guys, right? Yeah. Actually, her husband, you gotta even talk about what he does? No, okay, so forget it. I won't even joke about that. Okay. He's in the military, so he probably knows where I am. Okay, put it that way. Okay. So it's unacceptable. So it's unacceptable. All right. It's unacceptable. Let's make it at that. Okay. Okay. Ooh, guys, webinar. Come on, webinar jam people. Let's go. Let's give me some questions. Meerkat, I love you. So all these people on Meerkat, thank you so much. If you guys want to like the show, retweet the show, feel great. Let's see. So we got a question. She's very reactive on the leash and any noise. If we encounter a dog during the walk, she starts pulling on the leash. Okay. This is what I want you to do. And that's MZ Katu. Thank you. All right. This is what I want you to do. Prong collar, teach the dog how to walk on a prong collar properly. Okay. Teach the dog how to walk on a prong collar properly. No, some people, they don't like prong collars. That's fine. You don't have to use a prong collar if you don't want to. If you hire me, we use tools that work. But if your trainer, okay, this is another ploy that dog trainers do. Are you ready for this scam? Basic training, 6 classes, $129. You go through 6 classes. Your dog still can't do the commands. Why don't you sign up for another 6 classes? You're signed up for another 6 classes, another $129. Your dog still can't do stuff. Sign up for 6 more. I've had people that have gone through 3 to 4 classes. Can you imagine that? How about this? It takes 30 seconds to get a dog to walk on a leash. 30 seconds. It's not a miracle. It's not a miracle. I just put up a video today. I put up a video today of a dog that no one, the vet, the owner, couldn't touch it from the back, middle of the back, down to its hindquarters. I was massaging that dog today. Why? Because we changed the dog's energy. We changed the dog's energy. See, most dogs don't know how to behave properly. And most owners don't know how to communicate with dogs. It's a major problem. It's a big lack of communication problem. So, you know, a good example is I can give a highly trained dog to a unbalanced, unstable owner, and that dog would be out of control. They'd mess that dog up in 24 hours. Guaranteed. I see it all the time. Give me an out of control dog, it's fine. Like at the end of the day today, how long was that? We talked for about half an hour, 45 minutes. Dog that just came in today did a 45-minute place. A dog that just came in today and it wouldn't stop whining with its owner. The dog never stopped whining. It's attacked other dogs. It's got high prey drive. That dog was lying down. Actually, there's a photo of it. I think I put a photo of it on Facebook today. In place command for 45 minutes. I wasn't even holding the leash and it never broke command. Why? We changed the dog's energy. We changed the dog's energy. We communicated to the dog that, no, you can't move. It didn't stay there. Now, what's going to happen is a lot of people do this. There's a lot of idiots out there that'll be like, oh, the dog was afraid to move because you would correct it. Baloney. That's such baloney. That's an outright lie. It's actually an unethical lie. The dog didn't move because why? Because it knew it wasn't supposed to, because dogs are intelligent. All right? Okay. So you need to train your dog how to walk politely on a leash. I've got a video on how to size a prong collar, how to hold the leash, where the dog should be, and when to give your dog information. The dog being reactive on the leash, if it's reactive to noise, by properly healing your dog, you'll probably eliminate that right away. Okay. What I also suggest you do is this: go to my YouTube channel. I've got 18 different sound effect videos. Go to my YouTube channel, and it's in a playlist. So the way that a playlist works in YouTube is this. So on your phone, so on my phone, which is right in front of me, duh. On my phone, I can plug it into the stereo system. I can hit the playlist, 18 different effects, thunder, lightning, cars, cats, babies, dogs, name it. They all just continually play. Started at a low volume, slowly increase the volume. That's how you make your dogs bomb proof. Got it? Okay. People are liking this. Meerkat, they're liking this. They're retweeting it. Thank you guys so much. It means a lot to me. I just want you to know that. It means a lot to me. It really does. Okay. Thanks. BJ said, shepherds are coming out of the woodwork in Michigan. That's because you've got some really bad breeders up there. So excited to learn more from, especially in Detroit. Still working on a plan to get you to Michigan. Love your training ways and your positive energy. Starting tonight on your videos for fighting dogs. Again, thank you very much. BJ, thank you. You can get me to Michigan. You know how. All right? You know how. Elisa says, what kind of food do you feed your dogs? I've got 2 of my dogs are on the Volhard, Wendy Volhard diet. I get the number 2, which I call the lazy man's version. I just have to add water to the mixture and then add 80-20 beef. And then a lot of my dogs, I've got 9 dogs. So then I've got 2 of my Chihuahuas on Sojourn. So what's it called? Sojo's? Sojo's, S-O-J-O. It's a blue bag she gets. That's my wife's dog. Yeah, I know. Disappointment, ladies. I'm married. Yeah, believe it or not, someone did fall in love with me at one point in her life. I don't know. We could probably check in with her now and see if she still is. But she mixes that up with a mixture. But they're chihuahuas. So one bag lasts like, you know, 2 months. And then the rest of my dogs, I feed Canidae. So Canidae, C-A-N-I-D-A. I do the all life stages. So it's good. Okay. That answers that question. Okay. Let's see. Kira. Hey, Kira. Advice for dog chasing elderly cat in the house. I was thinking of putting her on a leash in the house until she can behave. The dog? Yeah. Oh, all dogs that are not trained should be on leashes in the house. So there's a couple of ways you can do, Kira. What you can do is your dog should learn the place command and downstay. And it also has to learn impulse control. Impulse control. So those are all the positive things you can do, the proactive things. I want my dog to go down and lay on that mat. And that's a weird concept for a lot of people. People are like, well, no, my dog will lie down over there. Okay, I know it will, but get up and go to the refrigerator. Where's your dog? Oh, it follows me. That's not training. Training is this. You put your dog into a downstay, you leave the room, the dog doesn't move. You put your dog into a downstay, you ring the doorbell, your dog doesn't move. You put your dog in a downstay, you drop food on the ground, your dog doesn't move. You put your dog in a downstay, the cat walks by, the dog doesn't move. That's dog training. So dog on a leash, place or down. Also, you at some point, you might want to have an aversive. We can call it a punishment and aversive. Any dog trainer out there that says they don't use punishments or aversives, number one, don't trust them. They're lying to you. Number two, they can't be that good. They can't. I'm sorry. You can't. You can't eliminate bad behaviors with training obedience. It's impossible. It is impossible. I talk about this all the time. Do we punish dogs? No, we punish behaviors. Do we use an aversive? Yes, we do. Absolutely. Welcome to the world. You're late for work, you get fired. You commit a crime, you go to jail. You speed, you get a fine. You hit your wife, I call my friends, they make sure you can't use your hands again. Okay? It's called life. Welcome to the world. Guess who understands life better than us? Dogs. So stop not acting like a dog and start acting and thinking like a dog. And dogs understand the way the world works better than we do. And you know what? Bad shit happens. So you growl at me? No, you don't anymore. You get into a fight? No, you don't anymore. You go after my kids, you may not see tomorrow. But guess what? Think of all the fun we can have. We do commands, we go on walks, we go swimming, we go hiking, we take, you know, my dogs go on an RV trip with me all the time, 10,000 miles. What dog wouldn't like to go on a 10,000 mile RV trip? This winter, I'm gone for 4 months in my RV touring the country. I'm bringing two dogs with me. Why? They're well-trained, well-behaved. That's why they can go. What aversives do you recommend? Kira, all depends on the, oh, you're the one with the cat. The thing is, I want you to fully remote collar train your dog. And then I want you to use a remote collar as an aversive, but you can do a leash pop. You can do a leash pop. You can also use a bonker. You can use a bonker. A bonker is a rolled up towel. So I don't have one here. Take a towel. You roll it up, so it should be end up being about that thick. Put elastics or rubber bands around it, just like three rubber bands. Your dog goes to chase the cat. You say no. You have to mark it with no. Throw the towel at the dog's head. It's a towel. It's not going to hurt the dog. All right. Dogs hate projectiles. Have two or three of them ready, because if the dog keeps going, you got to boom, boom, boom at them. They hate it. They hate projectiles, but mark it with no, no projectile, no correction. Okay, then no has meaning to it. Jeff, two questions. How much pressure should you apply when using a prong collar? My wife is afraid she is hurting. Your question got cut off at hurting. You're not going to hurt the dog. I've trained 3,000 dogs with prong collars. I've never hurt one in my life. The only time we see any sort of damage is on some of our pitties or dogs with no fur. There's a little bit of irritation right there. Okay. A prong collar has been designed. It has been designed not to hurt a dog. It looks barbaric. Of course it does. But any surgeons out there, you ever been in an operating room? You ever see some of the tools they use? Yeah, barbaric. Guess what though? It helps people. So prong collars do not hurt. Do not hurt. Watch my videos. Watch my how-to videos. But you also should be using a pop, not a pull. Prong collar is designed to pop and release. It's a very quick pop and release. Quick pop. So you want it to do pop, pop, pop like that. Up high on the neck, pop. How big of a factor is your posturing when training? Posturing, if you mean by your energy, if you've got bad energy, training doesn't work or doesn't work as well. You cannot be nervous. You cannot be afraid. You've got to be confident. You want to be strong. So it's not about male or female. I got 90-pound females that are very soft-spoken, but boy, can they train a dog. Clover, my 10-year-old, she can handle some really intense dogs. All right? So, all right. Okay, let me go through some of these questions. 10 o'clock already, 10:01. Hold on. We're winding down the show. Who's hanging in with me? Meerkat, you're hanging in with me? Webinar, you're hanging in with me? Good. Rhonda, I've been working with my lab with the boss on come, sit, break. It's going well. Can I also teach place while I teach the come command? How do I do it with the boss? Okay, awesome. So, Rhonda, so you're going to do come, sit, break. This is what I want you to start doing. Come. Rhonda, I want you to come. So, Rhonda, I want you to come with the dog. You're not supposed to laugh at stuff like that. This is exactly what's the conversation. She's like, don't laugh at that. Right? Are you right? Right? She's like, don't laugh at that. Okay. We got Texas over there. Okay. Anyway, I've been in Texas. Trust me, they're a lot worse than me. So, what I want you to do is, have food in your hand. Come, you're going to say place. Throw the kibble on the placemat. The dog gets on the placemat with the kibble. Then do sit. So come, place, sit. Also, that's if you want to use the food protocol. Also, I've got videos on how to do place with a remote collar. Look it up underneath do-it-yourself dog training on my do-it-yourself dog training on my YouTube channel, and you'll be able to see how I do it with no food, just the remote pressure. It's pressure on, pressure off, pressure on, pressure off. Okay. Doris, how many commands should a 14-week-old puppy be learning at a time? Is it too young to start training place? Absolutely not. 14-week-old puppy, you can do, in my world, Doris, a 14-week-old puppy, 14-week-old puppy, depends when I got the puppy. So if it's my first session, I would work on recall. So this is what your 14-week-old puppy should learn. Recall, sit, place, kenneling up, waiting at a kennel, not rushing through thresholds, no jumping allowed, down. So work on one a day, two a day tops. Use food. Use all the dog's daily kibble, not treats, food. So use the dog's daily. You want to eat, you're going to work. You want to eat, you're going to work. All right? That's what you're going to do. But don't worry about duration or distraction right now, Doris. Okay? Don't worry about that. If the dog downs, you give it kibble, it pops back up, don't worry about it. You'll take it. All right? But, oh, Doris, also do focus work. Get that dog to start doing focus. So if it sits and it looks at you, I got a focus video out there. You don't put the food in front of your nose. There's trainers that put hot dogs in front of in their mouth. That's impressive, right? Then they spit the hot dog down into the dog's mouth. That's disgusting. Okay? That's a very common training tool. No. I hold the food. So pretend this microphone is the dog's nose, food, and then my hands go out and the dog looks in my eyes. You want to talk about training? Think about it. The dog knows the food's in my hands. My hands are out. The dog looks in my eyes. That's focus work. Okay. A lot of questions. Lenise says, hey to my hubby up there who just asked, you and your husband are both on mirror? What are you guys like? Okay. Hi, Jeff. Bruno and I are doing better with remote collar healing. I'm a bit confused on correcting when my dog reacts to other people or other dogs. Do I use high E collar correction or use the dominant dog collar? Use the dominant dog collar. I want you to, Brian is the dog. Brian is the owner, and kudos to this guy. Jeez Louise. Brian is the owner of the, he came to my RV dog training seminar. Him and his girlfriend are working harder on this dog. This is a Dogo. And these are dogs who are bred to be aggressive. They're bred to hunt down and kill. It takes a special person to own one. And this dog dramatically changed in a weekend. Brian, what I want you to do is dominant hand out. So hand out like this. So self-preservation move, right? And remote at the same time, right? So uncomfortable and uncomfortable. Can you layer a prong and a knee collar? Which one do you put on top? Depending on what you're doing, but it should be the prong. The prong is up on top. Okay. Doree says, how do you keep them from jumping? You've got that 14-week-old puppy for jumping. Number one, it only gets fed and it only gets any sort of petting with 4 feet on the floor. If you do, this is what I want you to do, Doris. Look up my come sit break video. It might be called recall sit break. I want you to do that. That dog will know the only time it gets any food or affection is when 4 paws are on the floor. But how do you stop a dog from jumping? Use a leash pop. You make it uncomfortable. So what you do is the dog should have a leash on at all times. All 14-week-old puppies should have leashes on, right? So all dogs that are untrained should have leashes on. Unless your dog is underneath voice control and will listen to you, it should have a leash on it. So what you'll do is you pop the leash down. Another thing about the ethics of dog training, a lot of dog trainers, imagine this. This is said all the time. Take your dog to a dog training class. Take your dog to someone that calls themselves, we use science. First of all, anybody that says they use science to train dogs but doesn't use an aversive is a liar. It's unethical and liar. If you truly use science, there's four, I don't talk science here. Here I am, this is the second time I brought it up. There's 4 quadrants. 2 of them are aversive. They're negative. So don't tell me you use science. You don't. You're missing 50% of the formula. Right? So, this is what dog trainers suggest. I find this highly unethical and dangerous. Dog jumps. Turn your back. That's the stupidest thing you can do. Turn your back on a dog. Yeah. The dog's jumping on me and I'm turning my back. Uh-huh. And my wife wants to know when I went, did I go to Amsterdam over the weekend, right? No, you don't do that. Ignore it and wait till it stops. And when it sits, reward it. No. You correct it for jumping. You absolutely correct it. What does that mean? I will make it uncomfortable for you to jump on me or anybody else. This is what I want you to do. For the dog trainers out there that are recommending, and I know some of you are watching this show because I know who watches this show. Just a little bit of heads up, guys, all right? Okay? I don't care what name you put in to your little box there. I know who you are, okay? And I keep it private, but it allows me to track my haters. So what happens is people that don't like me, they like to watch the show and they like to take all these sound bites out of it and make me look really mean. Just show the whole show. I look mean the whole show. You don't need to do a sound bite, you know, please just show the whole show. What they do is this. If you're a dog trainer that suggests turning your back or ignoring, I want you to come to my training center with your 90-year-old mother, grandmother, great-grandmother, and a young child of yours under the age of 5, or a niece or a nephew, somebody you care about. And I've got some jumping dogs that we're going to try your theory on. Okay? So what you're going to do is you're going to be standing there with your that child, and I'm going to let a dog out in the training area, and it jumps. It jumps on everybody that it meets. And I'm going to yell to you, you're not allowed to do anything but stand there. Okay? You're going to have a handful of treats, and you're not allowed to do anything but stand there. And the dog's going to jump on you and jump on the little kid. And I'm going to keep saying, just ignore the dog. Just ignore the dog. Just ignore the dog. And if that doesn't work, I'll say, turn your back. Turn your back. Turn your back. And if that doesn't work, I'll say, tell them to sit. Tell them to sit. That's what you're telling clients to do. It's unethical. It's actually mean and evil and downright. You must really hate human beings for telling people to do that. How dare you tell people to do that? So what do? You correct them. I put up a video on YouTube. I've got a video on everything, guys. I've got a video on everything. I show my work. I show my work. All right. Lenise says, watch the videos on swim training. Are you using the prong collar to help get them in the pool and not working for... Yes, I am. I'm using the prong collar. Okay? Use the prong collar. It's not working for Queenie. Lenny, you're using your heart too much. Take your heart out of it. Use your head. Just do it. Got it? Just do it. Okay? You can do it. We taught that dog how to swim today, right? So we taught a... God, that dog's got to be 90 pounds, 100 pounds, 90 to 100 pound dog. That dog put up a fight, right? Put up a fight. I put a bunch of olive oil on the ramp. It slid right in. No, what happened was we used a lot of pressure, a lot of pressure. It fought me. It fought me. I'm not enjoying it. But guess what? Why do I quote unquote force the dog into the pool to start? I'm not throwing dogs in the deep end. It's not what I do. We have a ramp that goes into the pool, and I slow, consistent pressure pull. The dog got in and then swam 3 or 4 times. It took before it balanced out, and then would go in the pool. By the end of the week, that dog will be jumping in, chasing balls. MZ Katu, hey Meerkat, what's going on? Love you guys. When are you coming to Florida? I'll be in Florida. Lenny, you're right. It's me. I needed to hear that. Lenny, that's a broadcast question statement. Okay. When am I coming to Florida? I'll be in Florida for 2 months, actually. I've got a seminar January. Go to rvdogtrainer.com. rvdogtrainer.com. I've got a seminar in Ellington, Bradenton, which is south of Tampa, 2-day seminar, the, I don't know, 11th, 12th of January. Hold on. I'll tell you in a minute. You can go to rvdogtrainer.com, solidcaninetraining.com. January, I'm leaving on the 1st, 9th and 10th. I believe it's the 9th and 10th of January. I'll be in Bradenton, Florida, Ellington, Florida. I'm doing a seminar there. There's working spots. And then I'm also going to be down there probably for a minimum of 30 days. And I'll probably line up some other seminars. But that's a guaranteed seminar that I'll be doing. BJ Hater's going to hate. Oh, BJ, I'm so over that. It doesn't bother me. I like to get everybody riled up. That's all. Yeah. Haters don't. The great thing about haters is this. I love it. There's a couple of there's 2 online petitions that are out there that want to put me out of business. It's like, how do you do that? Like, how does that work? Do you realize that nobody looks at those? Like, nobody really cares. It's sort of like nobody cares about that stuff, but it's great. There's a couple of websites out there that put my videos up on their websites or on their Facebook page. And on their Facebook page, what they do is they put a video of mine and they bash me. Now imagine this concept. I don't know who these people are. So imagine this concept. They put my video, say, this guy's a terrible dog trainer. He's being mean to dogs. Okay. They put it up on their website or their Facebook page. Imagine 1,000 people that see it. 1,000 people. Imagine 990 of them hate me. But guess what? 10 people discover me. I love it. I wish everybody put my videos up there and say they hated me. I'd have so much business. It'd be incredible. You know why I'd have so much business? People that don't like me, they don't hire me. But people that don't know who I am and like me, they hire me. So I need more people to know who I am. If 10% of the people on a hate site liked what they saw, and 1 million people saw the videos over time, that's 100,000 people that like me. That would be awesome. So keep spreading them around. Oh, I love it. I love it. People always ask me, does it bother you when people share your videos and like say bad things? I love it. I can't ask. Thanks for the free publicity. Good. I've had news cameras show up on my door. It's like, good for you. Awesome. Jeff Gellman, Solid Canine Training. SolidCanineTraining.com. What do I care? And we're not doing anything wrong. That's the big thing. We're training dogs. All right, guys. Meerkat. Awesome. Loved it, guys. Good presence on Meerkat tonight. Let's do it better. Wednesday night, 9 p.m. Let's share this. Let's like it. Let's retweet it. All right. Let's follow me on Facebook. Stay up to date on Facebook. For anybody that's in the Rhode Island area, I'm having a garage sale. I know this sounds so silly, doesn't it? But I actually have a rescue. I'm having a garage sale Saturday afternoon at my training center. A ton of backpacking and hiking supplies. There's some kids stuff. There's old training supplies, rock climbing stuff. All right. Ooh, here's another one. Ta-da! Broadcast. Taya says, I have a certification in dog training. I've learned more information watching you than I did with a course. Thank you. What's that? No. There you go, Taya. So a little hint. I don't have a certificate in dog training. I didn't go to school for dog training. I didn't. I've met a lot of people that have, and there's more to life than going to school for dog training. You want to learn about dogs? Work with lots of dogs. Work with lots of dogs and try lots of stuff and take a chance. I'm not talking about dangerous things with dogs. Take a chance. Understand pure animal behavior. Pure animal behavior. Watch videos on wolves. There's a great video out there of a pack of wolves that just killed a moose. And there's 3 or 4 just about 1-year-old wolvettes, whatever you want to call them. Okay. One of them is on top of the moose. And all of a sudden, it growls. Could you imagine the balls on that freaking little shit moose? It growls. That head wolf came down on that little wolfette like you wouldn't believe. That little wolfette popped off the wolf. Guess what? Wasn't kicked out of the pack. It was instant. And the wolf came back and started eating again. But guess what? I guarantee you that wolf will never do it again. Ever. Ever. Okay? Well-timed, calm corrections that are fair are very important. Okay, Doug, thank you. This was a good one. Yeah, I felt good too, Doug. This is good. Akira, remote collar brand recommendations. Go to eCollar. I like eCollar. eCollar.com. The Mini Educator 300 are really great for about 90 to 95% of the dogs. The Boss is always good. It's a little bit more powerful. You got it. You got the power if you need it. All right. And hold on. Angelo, you say goodbye? Thank you. Say goodbye, Texas.
Bye.
All right. Madly in love with you guys. I really am. This means a lot to me. Meerkat folks, it really means a lot to me that you're watching. All my folks on Webinar Jam, really means a lot to me that you're watching. I love doing these webinars. Great questions, great interaction we had. Facebook, there's gonna be a lot of great content up on Facebook right now. I've got two shadows in from Texas. They're following me around and they're following John around and they're watching what we do. And all right, madly in love with you guys. Thanks a lot, really appreciate it.